Thank you. Wasn't that amazing how the drummer and the bass, Greg, and the bass just picked up on, he's got the whole world in his hands. That was so cool. And you're going to sing Amazing Grace, My Chains Fell Off during the communion. I'm tempted to rush through this to get there because it's such a wonderful song. You know, the bulletin, you know, we try not to take anybody for granted, but I tell you, Pat Meredith does an amazing job. I think there's so much in here, and I hardly ever see a mistake. You know, it's so easy to do in bulletins, and you've probably heard of these, what they call a bulletin bloopers or something like that. Here's a couple. For those of you who have children and don't know it, we have a nursery downstairs. The senior choir invites any member of the congregation who enjoys sinning to join the choir. You know, a G or an N makes a big difference. The low self-esteem support group will meet Thursday at 7 p.m. Please use the back door. The pastor will preach, the interim pastor will preach his farewell message, after which the band will sing Break Forth Into Joy. Gee whiz, those are just terrible. This past week we talked about how can I know God's will for my life, and you had some great input. I also mentioned that Jan and I sometimes will kind of have a funnel that we kind of place in front of us, and we have a decision to make, and we ask God, we don't want to be arbitrary, but by such and such a date, we really would love to have a good sense of what you want us to do. And so take all of the stuff, all the possibilities, and just kind of one way or another narrow them down so that we can walk by faith, but with some sense of confidence. Several of you mentioned wise and trusted friends that are meaningful to you. I remember this week, I went through a time where I did what I call next steps. And I'd be out walking, and in my prayer time, I would say, God, what's the next step in my relationship with you? And I'd listen for a while. What's the next step in my relationship with Jan? What's the next step in my relationship with our children? And I remember distinctly one time, on that particular note, I just had this overwhelming sense, tell your children you love them. Now, that might seem normal to you and natural, but I grew up with a great mom and dad, but we were Midwestern Ohio farmers, and you just didn't say that to each other. When Jan and I met, she's, you know, Jan's a lot more expressive, and so I loved our kids, but I just didn't verbalize it. It was hard. Anybody, you know what I'm talking about, some of you, don't you? And so I said, that's the next step. So I gathered the kids. I forget how old they were, but I was nervous as heck. And I said, you know, I didn't grow up this way. Dad and Mom loved me. I knew it, but just didn't tell me. I don't want to go through the rest of my life not telling you that. So I'm going to. Now, the beautiful thing is they tell their kids. And that was just one of those times of God's clear guidance for me. And you have ways of doing that. But you must have in the back of your mind, God, what if I miss your direction? What if I miss hearing that? What if I miss your guiding hand? And so I want to talk today about a deeper reality, I think, a deeper reality. And that comes from this beautiful Psalm 139, verses 1 through 10. And it's going to be from the New International Version. You love this psalm. I love this psalm. Talks about how close, how much God knows us. You've searched me, Lord, and you know me. You know when I sit and when I rise. You perceive my thoughts from afar. You discern my going out and my lying down. You're familiar with all my ways. Before a word is on my tongue, you, Lord, know it completely. You hem me in behind and before, and you lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, too lofty for me to attain. And then he goes into this other dimension. Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence when I want to? If I go up to the highest heavens, you're there. If I make my bed in the depths, you're there. If I rise on the wings of the dawn in the far east, if I settle on the far side of the sea on the west, even there, your hand will guide me. Your right hand will hold me fast. You get it? Anywhere you go, God's hand will guide you and will hold you fast. That's my point today. God's guiding hand. I love that poem by James Weldon Johnson called Creation, where God stepped out on space and looked around. He said, I'm lonely. I think I'll create me a world. And he smiled and life broke forth. And he grabbed the light in his hands and he rolled it up into a ball and flung it into the darkness and called it the sun. And he did that with his hands and all those other things. And then he said, I'm lonely still. And he sat down with his head in his hands and said, I think I'll make me a man. Sometimes picturing God with hands is a little challenging for us, isn't it? God whose spirit, God with hands. Do you remember that wonderful story? You've heard it probably many times about the little child, maybe 5, 6 years old, and his thunderstorm came by. And this child was frightened, came running out of her bedroom or his bedroom into his parents' bedroom. Mommy, I'm daddy, I'm scared. And they said, sweetheart, God is with you. Walk back to the bedroom and put him back in bed. God is with you. Next thunderclap, the child comes running back into the bedroom. Sweetheart, God is with you. Back to bed. 10 minutes later, huge lightning, thunder, and the child comes running in, and the parents say, what's the matter? And the child says, I know God is with me, but I think tonight I need a God with arms on. The hands. So sometimes seeing our hands. I've got a couple of pictures here. A friend of ours, David and Linda Yonatis, David takes these pictures of at hospice, I think, different generational hands. What's that picture say to you? Brings back memories, doesn't it? Your mom, your grandma, overlapping generations. Blessed is the child who has a grandparent or an uncle or an aunt who can tell them stories of the way life was and so that they know they're not just floating out here in space. They're grounded. They're rooted. We remember, because we tend to forget who we are. I remember 15, 16 years ago, I was going through a really hard time. I even had a panic attack or two. Some of you have had those. I was nervous. I was anxious. And I went to see a counselor, a guy that I became friends with, and he said, he knew I talked about my mom quite a bit, and he said, why don't you let your mom help you? I said, now, you know my mom is dead. My mom passed. He said, oh, I know that. But the veil between here and there is pretty thin. Why don't you let your mom help you? And so I would be in situations of anxiety, and I would feel mom's arms around me. And I would see a cardinal, which was her symbol, and I would have a sense that mom was with me. For years, I wouldn't tell anybody this story because I think they would think I was doo-doo-doo-doo-doo-doo. But I tell people now, especially when people lose a loved one, talk to your loved one. Talk to your loved one. I mean, we say it in the creed. We believe in the communion of saints. We read it in Hebrews chapter 12. We are surrounded by so great a crowd of witnesses, those who've gone before, who cheer us on from the other side. You've seen it. Somebody's close to passing on to eternity. The veil is almost not there. And they feel it. They remind us of who we are. Here's another picture. This is my friend's son and his granddaughter. Notice the hands, how he's helping her, holding her. You've done that. Somebody's done that for you, maybe lately. Somebody's just showed up at the right time. Today, I want you to look at your hands. You don't have to overdo it if you're uncomfortable, but I think of my hands. They picked me up when I was a toddler, when I fell. They put food in my mouth and sometimes in my hair and my ears and my all over when I was a little. They held the handlebars of my tricycle when I tried to run away from home. They held the handlebars of my bicycle. They helped me throw the baseball and feed the cows and the pigs and throw bales of hay. They tied my shoes and I went off to school. This one has my wedding band that reminds me that I belong to my beloved and we belong to each other. These hands held our children when they were born. These hands tossed them into the sky and caught them again. And these hands were folded in prayer as our daughter hovered between life and death. We cried out to God that he would let her live. And these hands, along with Jan's, stretched our daughter's constricted feet so that she could maybe walk one day as she recovered. And these hands have wiped away tears, mine and others. These hands helped me play golf, which I'm going to do this afternoon with my son and grandson. They're lifted in praise like we did today. Mom said they look like Dad's hands and Grandpa's hands. These hands, if they do all I've suggested, then God's hands will do the same and more. His right hand will sustain us. Jan's hands, similar things with the kids. This weekend she was getting together our son's 43rd birthday lunch. So we're going to take up there to Gainesville. Ham loaf, anybody? Dave and Grace? Ham loaf, that may be an Ohio thing. Mom did it. Mom was there with Jan, in a sense, when she was making this scallop potatoes. I hope you'll take 10 minutes today somewhere quiet and look at your hands, look at them, and ask God, what are you telling me with my hands? Mother Teresa of Calcutta, she would use her hands as she nursed and took care of those poorest of the poor. And when people would ask her about her hands, she said, you know, the gospel is in your five fingers. The gospel is on your five fingers. They said, what do you mean? Well, Jesus would say, when I was thirsty, you gave me something to drink. When I was hungry, you fed me. When I was naked, you clothed me. When I was in prison, whatever you did to the least of them, you did to me. You did it to me. Did you catch it? You did it to me. I think of Mary's hands as she held God that first Christmas morning. I think of Mary's hands as she held him close as they escaped to Egypt. I think of Mary's hands as she probably put them on his shoulders when he stayed back behind and said, Jesus, I don't care if you're God. Don't do that to me again. Oh, I don't know if she said that, but she probably thought it. And Joseph's hands, those strong hands. And then what about Jesus' hands? As he touched the blind man's eyes, and he touches yours, and lets you see from his perspective, as he touched Peter's mother-in-law for healing and touches you, as he reached down, knelt down in the sand, and wrote something there that pushed away those who would condemn a woman in their own power. And when he said a farmer went out to sow, and he talked about that in his strong hands that broke the bread of Holy Communion, that washed his disciples' feet, that folded in prayer in Gethsemane, that stretched out for the whole world, for you and for me. when his hands reached out for that one lost sheep and brought him back. Maybe he's bringing somebody back today. When he welcomed home the child who'd gone away. Today, your second assignment is in when you're quiet, let Jesus put his hands on your shoulders, and what's he going to say to you? I love you. Come back home. What's he going to say? My friend, Magre de Vega, who grew up in this church, his family still come to this church, I think generally at 11 o'clock. Magre de Vega, one of the sharpest, brightest, he's a clergyman. He's a pastor at Hyde Park United Methodist Church in Tampa. He reminded me of the movie Jan and I saw a few years ago called The War Horse. Have y'all seen the movie The War Horse? Oh, it's so good. It's based on the true story. I was researching this. There are like 1 million horses involved in World War I. Did you hear that? 1 million horses in World War I or more. And this is the story of one of them named Joey, who was born, and I think the boy's name is Arthur, on this farm in Devonshire of in Cornwall, England. And Arthur nurses this pony and loves this pony until it becomes a horse, and then it's conscripted into the war effort. And is in awful battles. I mean, you ought to see this. It's also a stage play. Barbed wire, just brutal stuff. And then the last scene is what happened to a number of horses. They feel like it's served its time. It's over. It's in such bad shape, you have to put it down. And so they're ready to put it down, and there's this whistle. It's the whistle that Arthur used as a child to call his horse Joey. And notice the hands. I think it's going to come up here on the screen. The last 2 minutes of the movie called War Horse.
What's your name?
Narcott. Private Albert Narcott, sir.
It's just a random horse, Narcott, and too badly injured. Is this man in your care?
Yes, sir. It's not random at all, sir. He's my horse. I raised him in Devon. Sir, look at his legs. He's got 4 white socks, he's brown all over, and he has a white mark here, like so.
Take him back.
Come on, son.
Oh, wait, you can't see because of the mud.
Thank you.
four white socks.
Are in that movie, aren't we? I mean, all of us are that horse. Battered, bruised. And Jesus rescues us. The waters of our baptism. And so today, when we come to Holy Communion, think of Jesus' hands that took the bread, the same hands that healed the blind, and raised the dead, and searched for you and for me, and said, come home. Remember who you are by remembering who he is, the body of Christ broken for you. And the blood of Christ shed for you for the forgiveness of all our sins. Would you pray with me as the servers come to the front? Oh God, pour out your spirit upon these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be his hands and his feet in the world. We thank you that you came from glory and came down and washed our feet, baptized our forehead, claimed us as your own, invited us to receive the bread, the cup of everlasting life. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.